Let's continue with our discussion of pricing strategy as one of the elements of the marketing mix as we create value for the marketplace. One concept in pricing that you should consider is how elastic is your price. For example, a product that when you make a change in price, there's not really a big change in the quantity demanded, is called inelastic demand because there isn't a lot of movement in quantity demanded when we change the price. So you can see here when we price increases from like 90 cents all the way up to $2.50, the demand doesn't change drastically. Yes, people will consume a little less, but not a significant amount. Contrast that with perhaps the change in demand of another product. Let's look at pizza. Perhaps at a dollar, you're willing to pay to buy 9 slices of pizza. But if a slice of pizza went up to $3, you would only buy 1. This means that when there's a change in price, there's quite a bit of a change in the quantity demanded. Therefore, the demand moves and is more elastic. So one might ask, which is more affected by changes in the economy? Products with inelastic demand or products with elastic demand? Well, it goes back and takes some consideration of our definition of disposable and discretionary income that we talked about earlier. Disposable income is income after taxes that is used for necessities. And since these items are necessities, they tend to have relatively inelastic demand. In other words, because they're necessities, we still have to buy them even if the price increases greatly. However, products that are bought with discretionary income, in other words, products that are bought after we buy necessities and that's used at our discretion and we get to choose whether or not we purchase, tend to have relatively elastic demand. In other words, we don't have to need them. They aren't necessities. They are things bought at our discretion. So therefore, we may choose to not purchase that anymore. You can find further discussion and a written summary of price elasticity, how much the demand for a product changes with a change in price at this particular website. Another thing to consider when pricing your product is how many will you have to sell to break even? And to calculate our break-even point, we need to differentiate between fixed costs and variable costs. Variable costs are costs that change with the quantity produced. For example, if you opened an ice cream shop, variable costs would be milk, ice cream cones, the napkins that you serve it with, maybe toppings that you serve. Basically, the number that you produce uses more of these items that have a variable cost. But costs that don't change with the quantity produced. For example, the rent or lease on your ice cream building, basic electricity costs, insurance cost, maybe the cost of your ice cream machine. Those costs are fixed. They don't change regardless of how many you produce or sell. The bottom line, though, from a marketing perspective, is that to really break even, you have to not just cover the variable costs, but also the fixed costs of operating your business. So we can calculate break even in units, in other words, how many units you have to sell, by taking the fixed costs and dividing it by the average unit price minus the average unit cost. Now keep in mind the parentheses are here, so we're going to need to do this calculation first. And that basically tells us if you think of how much you sell each ice cream cone for, let's say $3, and you subtract the cost, the average cost of each ice cream cone, let's just say that's $2, that means 3 minus 2, every cone that you sell will contribute $1 toward your fixed cost. So you would take your fixed cost, let's say your ice cream machine, your lease, that sort of thing, and divide it by what each individual unit you sell contributes to the fixed cost to get a break even in units or a quantity that you will need to sell to break even. Let's look at an example. Let's say you open a jewelry business and your fixed costs are $1,000 per month. And let's say that the costs of the variable cost for each item you sell, each bracelet or whatever, is $50. So if you look at, if you priced your items at $70, each item you sold at $70 would cost you $50. So that means you would have $20 to go towards your fixed costs. So you take your fixed costs, $1,000, and divide it by the contribution that each one makes towards your variable costs, which is 20. And 1,000 divided by 20 means that if you sold 50 units, you would break even. You would cover your fixed and variable costs. Now, what happens if you increase your price to $80? Well, here each unit you sell is contributing $30 towards covering your fixed costs. So you would take 1,000 and divide it by 30, and you'd find that if you sold 33 units, you would break even. What if you decide that you'd like to sell more? And so you think if you lower your price, you'll sell more. So in this case, let's say you price your product at $60. Your cost is still $50. So now each one you sell only gives you $10 to go toward covering your fixed costs, which would be $1,000. So now you would have to sell 100 units to be able to break even. So you can begin to see how pricing strategy definitely affects the profitability of your organization. You can calculate break even in dollar revenue sold by taking your price and multiplying it times the units you sell. So you can see if you sold 100 units, if you priced your product at $60, you would actually have to sell $6,000 worth to break even. And if you priced your product at $80, you would have to only sell $2,640 worth to break even. The question is, are people willing to pay $80 for your bracelets? I mean, you may say, gosh, that's what I want to do. But if people in the marketplace aren't willing to pay that, if they don't see the value of your product and your promotion and your distribution with your price, then it doesn't matter what you want to sell it at if they aren't willing to pay that amount.